Thanks everybody for coming. My name's Lee Kushner, and I'm going to talk about something that's been kind of permeating the conference, the concept that there is a huge talent shortage in the information security industry, that people are having significant troubles recruiting. And you know, look, my hope is that you come out of the presentation with a lot better understanding of how to maximize your time, how to become more efficient, and essentially become better recruiters. So, I think that's the wrong button. All right, so just so you guys know, there'll be no ghosts on the slides. Just learn through the years that catchy titles are good to get your presentation accepted at RSA. But look, the presentation, my style is normally a very interactive approach because I know this is pretty personal to everybody. So I'll ask questions. I hope they get some participation. I was watching Match Game on ABC the other night, and I was thinking of recruiting is blank. So I know first word that pops into people's mind when they think of recruiting and their experiences. Shout out. Tedious. Good. That's a match. Next. Anything else? Fun? Painful? How about the hardest part of my job, right? I think that recruiting, when I talk to people, the thing that I hear from most of the people I talk to that are going through the same challenges that you guys do is simply that it's the one component of my role that I have absolutely no control of. I'm reliant on so many other external factors, including the ultimate variable, which are humans. And it's the one thing that I can invest the most amount of time and get the least amount of yield in it. Look, recruiting is essential to any CISO or information security leader or any head of a function, that if you're able to build a solid team, your job becomes easier, you're able to get more resources, you're able to be more efficient, you're able to demonstrate more value. So recruiting has to be a real important element to your role. And you know, probably the underlying principle that people deal with, it really causes a lot of conflict, is that people think that recruiting is about what have you done in the past. How many people follow the stock market, right? I mean, the stock market is not an indicator of past results or past valuations. It's really the value of the future values of the company, the future revenues. And when you think about talent, you're not looking at data that is, what did the person do in the past? What experiences the person completely had? Or what even that person was earning? It's pretty interesting, like whenever, I don't know if you guys work with your HR functions, but you ever say that, well, how do we determine future compensation? People say, well, we're gonna give 10% more. Like, if you guys were changing jobs, how much would you expect of the pay increase to be if you are changing jobs? Is there like a percentage that you would look at? 10%? How about anybody looking for higher than that? 15%? 30%? It's like an auction here, right? Well, the truth is this, right? When you're a candidate, you could look at the job about kind of what is my market value, right? And like, instead of thinking about why your market value about like what you were earning, it's kind of like, if my skills were in the open arena, what would people pay for the value that I would provide for them, right? So when you start thinking about that, like, you know, part of the whole concept is that you have to think of your strategy not based upon the past, but you have to think about your strategy about what is it going to take, and what does the future look like for the attraction of those people, right? So, You guys have any ideas like why your own, I mean, is anybody here because they're like really great at recruiting and it causes no pain and they filled all their positions and life's good? Anybody? I mean, like, here's all these reasons that recruiting fails, right? I mean, it's really, they're all different things that can be set up in the design of a recruitment process that can actually inspire, the design of the process will definitely dictate the end results, right? And, you know, there are all sorts of things, competition for talent, the fact that we don't want to admit it, but we're not really good salespeople and we're not really good leaders in getting the resources and the tools and the budgets that we require to be successful in this. Internal inefficiencies, like process, right? The length of time to identify the candidate, to walk them through your processes, to get an offer letter produced, to go through a background check. All these different times, all these different elements that are kind of obstacles to being able to get to a decision point. Compensation, and just, I mean, overall lack of skills. But, I mean, the one thing that's really governing, you know, how we're thinking about recruiting is the fact that it's very simple. It's supply demand, right? What kind of data points have you seen recently in the news about the scarcity of information security talent? How many open positions have you been reading the articles? They say there's a million open security positions. How does that make you guys feel good about your career choices? Right? I mean, ISACA came out with a survey saying that 59% of they're told that the time to fill positions, that only 24% of their respondents were able to fill positions within 3 months. That means 76% of their people, of their respondents, couldn't fill their positions in a 3 month time period, right? And the truth of the matter is that your candidates know that it's a seller's market, right? If you think about if you were out there looking for a position, how picky would you be? Right? And, you know, when you have options in the market, whether they're real options or there's the perception of options, people's demands, people's requests, people's, the things that they scrutinize for decisions are significantly more, you know, intense, right? So when it comes down to it, you have to really think about it that when, you know, if people are saying that I'm in short supply, so the ability to attract that person, their demands just generally go up. So what I'm hoping to hear is that today I can lay out kind of a successful blueprint, talking about some very basic steps that you can take and you can apply back to your current role. And it's just, here's an overview, right? So, I mean, first you have to really be able to build mind share and you have to be able to bring people together. Like when I talk about this, right, who are the types of people that you have to work with in order for a recruitment process to go down? And who do you guys partner with? There's obviously human resources, right? How about your management? Getting budget, getting salaries approved. You have to be able to talk to your interview team, the people who are part of your interview process. And when you get there, you have to educate them with real data. You can't just say, you know, bring them one article that say there's a shortage of a million people. You have to be able to talk to them in terms where you could truly give them data that lets them have a good understanding of the problem and the obstacles that you would face and what impact it would have to your business if you were not able to attract that talent and build that skill in order to protect your company. Because as a leader, you commit to certain things that enable you to be the responsible party for information security in your organization or for your function. And in order for you to do that, if you can only rely on yourself, if you're not building a team of capable people, you're probably gonna fail in your role, and then they're gonna hire somebody else because you have not succeeded as a leader, right? People talk in the CISO world about all the hurdles of being a CISO and the concept of self-preservation, right? I mean, like, CISOs are kind of an endangered species out there because when everything's going right, nobody thinks of anything, but when something goes wrong, they're the fall person, right? So the way that you're able to do this is that you have to bring your executive team, your HR teams, and people who are going to ultimately impact what you're able to offer, how you're able to manage a process, you have to be able to bring them into the conversation, and you have to be able to kind of give them real data so that they can do it. And some of these sources of data will be things that they can consume, right? You, if you're going to talk to your executive management, you should bring them you should bring them articles or data points that are dealing with for things that they read, right? Or if you're dealing with human resources, you can say, look, you know, we've had these jobs open for X amount of time period, and let me tell you the reasons why. So you have to really be able to give them real data so they can recognize that they have a unique problem on their hands. They're going to come back to you and ask you for certain things. You're going to have to give them deliverables. And whenever they ask you for something, you have to be able to be prompt, give them real strong things that they can say, like, you know what, this makes sense. I think that people in general will respond to logic. And I think that if you give them cause and effect statements for why things aren't working or what you need, you probably have a better chance of actually attaining them. And look, as a security leader, do you guys have to sell a lot? I mean, internally, I mean, aren't you selling to all your technology teams, the compliance team, the business, the importance, the value of security? Well, you now have to be your biggest advocate here. You're the one who truly has to sell the concept of the value of bringing in a capable team, because ultimately you have the most negative impact if you're not good at this. Because if you don't have a good team, you can't build a good program. And if you don't have a good program, your environment's not going to be secure. And if you're the low-hanging fruit and something goes bump in the night, they're going to find somebody else to do your job. And look, when you're giving them this information, what you want to be able to do is ask them for deliverables in return. You want to be able to design things to say, like, well, look, if you bring me the right candidate, we'll figure out compensation. Okay, what is that? What is my limit, right? Or if we're going to have offers, how quickly are they going to get turned around? What do you need from us in terms of support? If your internal team can't fill the position, what are my external options for bringing talent to the organization? What kind of investment will you make for me in terms of hours of your internal recruitment teams, resources, advertisements, things that you might think might attract people, maybe presence at career fairs? Now remember, I'm not talking about recruiting kids off college campuses, and I'm not talking about recruiting inexperienced talent that you will train up, right? I'm talking when you have a very present problem and you have an itch that needs to be scratched. You have to determine what is the best option for you to fill it, and then you have to make the business cases, just like you make the business cases for technology, for budget, for consulting fees, whatever you do. You have to be able to dictate to your team, and you have to be able to go out and request budget to be able to recruit, right? So now you're kind of ready to play. You've kind of laid out the framework and stuff like that. It's just crazy. You know, one of the most important things you have to do is really understand your audience. So, I mean, I think the best way to talk about, like, how people think about their job changes, like, what would be reasons that you would all change jobs? Or have you, that reasons that you've changed jobs in the past? Anything? Nobody's changed jobs? What? Management? Leadership? What else? Lack of leadership? Company strength? Engagement of the work? Boring problems? chance to learn new things, right? Just being stale, you can't be successful if you're running in place. What else? Nobody said money. Money, okay. Commitment, right? People talk about commitment, right? So like, I mean, so the, what you, I mean, these are all things that you guys talk, culture, quality of life, work from home policies, flexibility, technology. My leadership actually cares about what we do. We're doing security for compliance sake, right? So ask yourself, the people who you're trying to recruit, why would they think any differently? Like, we're all human, right? So we all have the same motivations, right? So you have to think about, like, why your candidate is ultimately interested in leaving what they have. And then, like, what you have to figure out is, like, what do you have to offer? So when you guys think about recruiting and competing for talent, who do you think that you're, like, you're competing with? Okay. In the old days, people would just compete with the current employer, right? Like, somebody is working at a job and they say, well, I just have to be better than that job, or I have to be better than status quo in order to attract somebody. And the truth of the matter is that when you guys interview people, do you guys only interview one candidate? No, right? So let me ask you a question. When your candidates are looking for jobs, do you think that they're only looking and interested in your opportunity? No, right? I mean, if you're looking, you're trying to find the best fit for your company, and they're trying to find the best fit. So when you're bringing that candidate in, the better that candidate comes into your office, think about it this way. If you're thinking, wow, this person's really good, all the other places that that person is interviewing at is thinking the exact same thing. And what those candidates are doing, if they have the skill, is truly creating a market for their talent. And it's not a market of the past, what they're currently doing. It's a market about, it's the futures market. It's what the market will kind of pay and the kind of things that the candidate might be able to demand for their skill. At this point in time, talented candidates truly have the most leverage, right? So one of the key things that you have to do before you start recruiting is you have to understand how you win. And recruiting is competitive. How many of you have ever played competitive sports? Right? There's a lot of folks, right? And you think about, like, what it takes not just to be good, but you have to be better than the rest, right? So you have to figure out up front, like, what are the things that you can offer to your pool of people that would make somebody want to choose you, right? And you know what? We can't always offer everything, right? So let me give you just like what I consider to be like, what I consider to be really like losing recruitment philosophies, right? How many people say like people should want to work here, right? I call that overconfidence. We have tremendous commitment. Who said that? Who's ever said that to one of their candidates? Nod your heads, I know you have. And those are table stakes. Everybody says the same thing, like that's not enough. How about when you tell a candidate, hey, I took a pay cut to work here. Has anybody ever said that to a candidate? Like, I could earn more other places, but I like to work here. That's irrelevant. Like, what works for you is not the same motivations that your candidates have. Or that, this is my favorite when we deal with smaller companies, that the value of your stock is gonna change your life. It's a life-changing thing. Like, that to me is like false promises, wishful thinking, and, you know, if I had a dollar for every time I heard this, I would be on a beach somewhere. But, and the other one is like, we're just like Google, Facebook, and Netflix, which I kind of sum up as know thyself. And the truth is, like, you can say that if you are Google, Netflix, and Facebook, but like, many people say like, well, I'd like to have a candidate who comes from that place or that place. But the truth is, like, you probably don't have the ability to win in those environments, right? So these are all types of things where your organization could win, because probably you can't win everywhere. But you have to think about the things in your organization that kind of creates a pull funnel for people to come. And look, every organization has something that translates very well to a select group of people. So you really have to identify what those things are and hopefully make those things, be able to go out and communicate that, and hopefully in some way be able to lure people based upon those things. So like if you know that you can't pay a lot of money, but that you have a great commitment to training and future education, those are things that you should be selling. Or like maybe, maybe that you have a work from home policy, or maybe you have something that enables people to work remotely, or you're able to offer really great benefits, or some level of trust and stability. Somebody said that they left because their company wasn't doing well, right? I mean, all these different things matter to these people, and a lot of this stuff really kind of gets summed up in a term that people refer to as culture, right? So you have to truly understand what are the things about your place that make you unique, and that if you're in a competitive situation with people who are viewing the same kinds of candidates and looking for the same kinds of roles, how are you able to go out and win when that candidate truly has choices? Job descriptions. Any guys' thoughts on job descriptions? How many think job descriptions are really well written? Okay, so we have some thoughts, that's good, right? I mean, so I got two basic philosophies that job descriptions are written poorly and information security professionals are really good information security professionals, but they're not professional resume writers, right? So like, at the end of the day, like, you know, just like you're looking at people's resumes and you're saying like, wow, these people can't write resumes, guess what? The reaction that you had about people who are looking at job descriptions, you're thinking like, they're thinking these job descriptions are horrible, right? So like, let me tell you the things that I think make a bad job description. Some of these things you might say, well, how would it be possible to write a job description without a title, right? Doesn't all job description have title, right? Well, think about it this way. All these things that we're talking about here are what I consider to be limiting factors, right? These let people take their own impressions and completely tie them into the things that are written on the page. So they truly don't allow you any flexibility. For like, how about years of experience? How many of you guys write job descriptions with years of experience requirements on them? Can somebody make a case to why years of experience is a good thing to include in a job description? I mean, it's kind of standard. Go ahead.
It sets a minimum bar.
Let me ask you, I'm going to ask a question in the room to everybody, because I think I agree that it does set a minimum bar. But what are we looking at a minimum bar for? Are we looking for a minimum bar of years in, or are we looking for a minimum bar of capability? For example, if I gave you a choice of two candidates, let's call it like a Unix security specialist. Let's say that we had somebody who had 10 years of Unix systems administration and security experience, and they basically had a 9 a.m. they show up for work, 5 o'clock they go home, and you know they do Unix security from 9 to 5. Or if I give you somebody who's had 3 years of Unix security experience, and they've been doing CTF since they're in high school, and that they've been, they have a home lab and they're running a whole bunch of servers on that, and when they come home, like they're going to Usenix security conferences, and they went out to Enigma a couple weeks back in Oakland, and they have a GitHub where they're building Unix kind of security technologies and sharing tools, which candidate would you want to hire? Who would hire the first one with 10 years of experience? Who'd hire the second one? All of my clients would hire the second one in a heartbeat. So years of experience is kind of like an obsolete metric, right? Like it would make sense if I was like hiring maybe a real estate attorney or an accountant or something where the years of experience are incrementally important. But when it comes to technology and things that are moving so quickly, especially in security, it's the richness of the experience that's more important than the duration. Now, yes, there's going to be certain things that if I do something long enough, I put my 10,000 hours in, I'm going to get better at. But generally speaking, like when you start, so you start eliminating really good people when they see 10 years of experience and they know they only have three, right? How about like certification? How many people have certification requirements in their resumes and their job descriptions? Let me ask you a question. Go to any boutique security consultancy. What percentage do you think of like when Mandiant was like really the number one place in IR, and they still might be, what percentage of those folks had certifications in IR? You think all of them did? They're charging $600-$700 an hour for their time. And I guarantee you most of them did not have certifications. Right? You could think about any of the boutique security consultancies that are out there where their people generally kind of chuckle at certifications. So certifications or education, like they might be some minimum baselines of care, but generally speaking, like that doesn't, just because somebody's certified doesn't mean that they're qualified. So I think that when you start doing this, you start limiting more things, right? Or how about when you, how about job descriptions that like combine everything and they bring it into one person and you have like a job description where you need like 5 years of application experience, 4 years of cloud experience, 7 years of infrastructure experience, and you've been able to manage a team and lead a team and work in three different industries, right? So people write these job descriptions about things that like they don't understand that they either don't exist or they simply cannot afford the talent that they're looking to think. And you think about any economy or any market, the bid has to equal the ask. So when you write a job description, you have to be able to write it in a way where you know that the things that you're putting down on that paper are A, number one, skill combinations that make sense for your job, and two, that if you did find that person, that you could afford to actually hire them. I mean, in a nutshell, right, like losing job descriptions are written like, I'm gonna go find the purple unicorn or whatever they call it, right? Like I heard in a presentation the other day that I want to find a ninja, but pirates eat ninja. I've heard that somewhere, but like generally speaking, right, losing job descriptions really kind of center on like, I'm gonna find the one person in the world that can do my job. And it doesn't work, right? So like, when you write a really good job description, the whole goal is to create a funnel, right? And to be able to engage as many possibly good candidates where you could bring that talent to your organization and you get a real opportunity to truly understand if these people are capable of functioning and succeeding and eventually thriving in your organization, right? So, I mean, here are, I tell you, like all really good components of a successful job description. Like, first of all, you guys see those job descriptions where it's like bullet, 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 like everything's a bullet, right? You need to write your job descriptions as stories, right? You have to write them as a narrative. You think about your job description as your marketing document out to the world about your security program, right? And, you know, when you write it, understand, like, why are you writing it? You're writing it to attract people. So you're writing it with a purpose, right? So bringing it in there, right, you want, what do you want somebody, when you write one, right, when you see it out there, or when you're looking at one, what do you want the job description to say to you if you were the candidate? Like, what did you want it to say, like, hey, that's me, or that's not me, right? So, like, you want the candidates to be able to self-select in or to like respectfully opt out. So if you're able to create a story around that job description and write it in a way where it's telling them a little bit more about your environment, the things that are important to you, the types of people that succeed, the things that might be nice to have or the things that like maybe you're willing to train up on, or to talk about things about your culture of your environment, or like why your team is like really good and successful. These are things that you should be able to talk to in a job description, and then these job descriptions should become guides to the eventual interview process. Because all the things that you're telling a candidate about what makes them interested in the job should be reflected when they come into the interview process. So when you're writing these things, right, you need to ask yourself these questions, right? Like, you know, would it generate interest, right? Like, who is my job a better option for as a likely candidate, right? Like, I laugh a lot of times when people go, they change jobs, and their idea is that they're gonna go out and recruit somebody who's doing the exact same job at one company to do the exact same job at another company, right? Like, to me, like, that's the concept of, like, I'd like to change t-shirts, I'd like to get a new pullover or something like that with a new company name. Like, so people don't understand that recruiting is truly the intersection of the employer's need and the candidate want, right? The employer needs something, they need to be able to solve a problem, and the candidate wants future opportunity. The candidate wants something that's better than their status quo, right? So when you're thinking about it and you view your job description, like, am I communicating clearly, right? And then if you just had your job description, right? Do a little self-reflection. Like, if I was the person that I wanted to hire, would I be interested in this job? I mean, and you really have to step back from it, because you don't know anything about what day in the life is in your organization if you're that candidate from the outside, right? So you have to think about things like, would I have been interested? What kind of money do you think I would have wanted if I was that person? And you have to really be honest about it, right? And I think that, you know, there's a certain level in honesty about thinking about who your audience is as they view that job description, and is it really written to be able to bring that person to my door who I think will ultimately be a really good match for my organization, right? So this is like the big reveal here, right? Becoming the recruitment champion. Like, do you guys have any, like, what do you think that this means to? Any thoughts about like what it would mean to be the recruitment champion? Go ahead.
The people you hire turn out to be stars and they stay.
Okay, the recruitment, that would be the ultimate end result, right? I mean, recruitment and retention kind of go hand in hand, right? When I think about being the recruitment champion, I tie that into the prime motivation of why I have to be the recruitment champion if I want to be a successful security leader, right? My number one goal is self-preservation, right? And the best way to do that is by bringing great people to my team, because the better my team is, the better I am. And the better I am, the more job security I have, the more accolades I get, the easier it is to get budget, the more marketable I even become if I was to look outside, right? So being a great recruitment champion is a very selfish-driven type of organization, right? It's a very selfish mentality, but like when you're the recruitment champion, you're not just doing it for your organization, you're doing it for yourself, because the better your team is, probably the more time you have, the more things that you can push off to your people. The more competent the people who are around you, the better things that it frees you up to do things that are more strategic, that are more valuable, and truly that can be more influential, which really is going to be the ultimate end game for a successful CISO. Right? You have to be able to be that ambassador of security for your organization. And if you could have people that can mind the store when you're doing that and feel great, like when you guys go on vacation, like how many times are you looking at your Blackberries or your phones or your email, right? Because you're worried about what's happening when you're not there. Does anybody go on vacation and like completely unplug because they feel completely confident that their team's taking the job? Well, if you guys are able to do that, like that's wonderful. Like that's great, right? I mean, but that is a personal motivation, right? Being able to take a peaceful vacation, right? So in my experience, right, the most successful recruitment initiatives and programs that we've been a part of is when the CISO is personally involved in the interview process. And when I say personally involved, they truly become the recruitment champion, which includes being accountable, being the designer of the recruitment process, being accessible and putting in input and making time and taking part in interview processes and taking part in feedback discussions, really is the champion and is the top salesperson in that organization. They are the prime advocate and they're also always playing to win. Let me ask you a question, is interviewing a democracy? Who thinks interviews are a democracy? Nobody. Right? So I like to channel my favorite football coach, Bill Parcells, when he says that if you're going to expect me to cook the meal, you have to let me shop for the groceries, right? So when it comes down to it, like understand that your team, the people who you trust and that you like, they have different motivations than you have, right? Your responsibility is to protect the organization and to be accountable for everything. Their motivations, probably part of that, but their motivations are also to become you one day. And their motivations is to make sure that they stay highest in the pecking order amongst their peers, so they're considered for more promotions, they're considered for more opportunities, they get bigger raises, they get more money. So you have to really understand is that, you know, you have to be able to make sure that while people get input and they earn more input, you are the ultimate voice and you set the ultimate framework for what recruiting is like. And that means you become the chief recruitment architect. You know, how many of you guys have defined principles when it comes down and standards that you guys use and disseminate to your team when it comes to interviewing? If you don't have them, create that. How many of your interviewers have defined roles? Like, do you tell your interviewer, you're screening for this, or you're screening for that, or you're screening for something else, right? You have to do that, right? How many times do you guys have interviews where there's one person on your team that basically is the office of no? That nobody's ever good enough for that person, that that person's better than everybody, and that they're always either, they can give ambiguous feedback, like, I don't think they're a culture fit, or like, you know, they're not technical enough, right? Like, there's always some sort of data point that one person, in all of our places, there's always, like, whenever we get an interview schedule, there's always that one person we're always like, yeah, that's gonna be hard. But, like, do you guys have that in your teams? I see some nodding, which is good. Right? The one thing you have to do is you have to make your team accountable for recruiting. Make it part of their compensation. Make them have to defend their feedback. Make them actually take ownership of their component of the recruitment process. I would tell you that in any company that has a bonus plan, recruiting should make up a small recruitment and personal management, retention should be a component of their compensation. Designing your process, you have to build consistent lineups. You have to let people prioritize interviewing, because if you build the consistent lineup, you're getting repeatable feedback, and you're also getting like the basis of comparison. Understanding that interviews are unnatural, right? So what you want to try to do when you're designing these interviews is make them like it's going to be a day of the life. As if you were going to work here, what would my day be like, right? What kind of problems would our person solve? What kind of interaction would the person have with the other team members, right? Create scenarios, whiteboarding sessions, right? You want to encourage that person to ask questions and really take part in the interview itself. so that they feel that, like, you want to create a comfortable environment, because when you create a comfortable environment, you see how people truly act in a work situation. Because how unnatural is an interview, right? You come in, 30 minutes, like, by the time you get to know somebody, like, it, the interview's over, and you're like, yeah, I wish I would have asked them a whole bunch more questions, right? Or if you're the interviewer, you're like, wow, there are four or five questions I never got to, right? So you have to be able to create an environment which enables you to get these feedbacks, right? So, like, before the candidate comes in, I encourage you all to give the candidates transparency. These are the kinds of things that we ask. This is the kind of format that we have. Here's the people you'll be meeting with, and these are the people who you'll be interacting with. It should not be a poker game. You want the candidate to come in and understand that, like, let them be themselves so you can figure it out. Here's where sales comes in, right? So you have the interview, they've come through the process, right? And, like, we want to hire this person, right? People think that their job's over. This is when you tie it back to holding everybody accountable in the first slide. Right? So what happens is this, is that all the things that you made them to talk to, how much money you're going to pay, the SLAs for delivering offers, the kinds of things that you need from me in order to make a business case to hire the person or approve the money, all these things that you have to do, this is kind of when it happens, right? So this is where your personal involvement and your championing of the process, really driving it to the finish line, is the most key, because now you've invested all this time, and if you drop the ball now, it's all been a waste, right? So, like, look, the candidate starts getting the balance of power here. You've already defined that you like them, right? So, like, when you get involved, the candidate gets to see what it would really be like to work with you, right? It really becomes a dress rehearsal for, like, how will I be treated if I wind up working in your organization? And giving that candidate access and giving them truth and not giving a filter or hiding behind a third party, being present makes a huge impression on people because they feel that they're going to be dealt with straight. And look, understand your candidate. When you're a candidate, what do you guys think if you interview for a job? Like, what's reasonable for you to get feedback? A day? 2 days? What's reasonable? You think, like, a week's reasonable?
No.
No, okay, but you know what, though? Most people don't give feedback for that time. Or just kind of like a generic answer, like giving candidates some real data, right? Things that were good, things that you have questions on. That transparency is fine. What about decision-making for offers? How quickly do you, after you give a candidate offer, how quickly do you expect the candidate to tell you yes or no? 2 days? Huh? 2 days? 3 days? You think candidates that are desirable respond well with guns to their head and say you have to make an offer in a short period of time? The answer is this, is that you need to set expectations. You need to deal things reasonable. Remember supply and demand. If you force people to make quick decisions, they think that you're hiding something. So you should be able to give reasonable time for the candidate to interview you back in the process. Be accessible. Engage the candidate, bring them in for a lunch. Hey, you know what, we're gonna do a happy hour. You wanna come, that would be great. We're gonna do a lunch and learn. Why don't you come and meet the team and spend some more time? Those things make it very difficult for the candidate to say no, right? So look, here's the apply slide that we have to have in our RSA presentations. So this will be like, these are things that you could take back, right? I mean, I think that the most important thing that you could look at is that you really have to reflect on the things that you're doing well and the things that you're doing poorly. And if you're not being very successful as a recruiter in your organization and you have unfilled positions and you can't keep doing the same thing over and over again and expect a different result. It's just not gonna work. And here's my recruitment math or my recruitment equations. And it's kind of like a flow chart, but, you know, better, like, it's all kind of like, these all make sense, right? Better recruitment, better talent. Better talent, better program, better security. Company safer, greater appreciation. Greater appreciation, greater authority of budget. Greater authority of budget, greater authority and greater budget, easier recruitment. So Look, there's a focus on, which is kind of like a more informal session. What room is it?
2009 at 2:45.
Okay, it's room 2009 at 2:45. It'll let you kind of ask and answer any questions about you guys might have personally. We could go into some deeper things, some case studies. But I really appreciate your time. Hopefully you guys have learned something, and thanks for being a great audience.